어떻게 됐니? 오케이. He said that the book is going to be ready by this afternoon, huh? So probably you can have the book on Wednesday. Let's see. Well, let me introduce the chapters that we are going to cover in this lecture first. This might be a little bit different from the notebook that you're going to have, but don't mind. Is it unfocused? Yeah, 이거 포커스가 맞네, 이거? 뭐가 좀 이상한데? 응. 괜찮아? Well, can you read? Chapter 1, VLSI device and technology, and 2 and 3 are devoted for the introduction of skilled NMOS technology and bipolar technologies. So advanced VLSI process. I'm going to make an introduction of these two processes first. And then from chapter 4, we're going to deal with the micron-sized devices physics, okay, so fabrication physics, and we start out with the point defects. There are many defects, but we are mainly concerned the point defects, and I'm going to tell you why we are interested in the point defects instead of other old line defects and volume defects and things like that. Okay, and then it consists of point defects and diffusion, oxidation, and implantation and gathering. And we are going to talk about the ideal scaling of MOS devices. There is a basic principle how we can reduce the size, okay, sort of rules, scaling rules. And then the next chapter is the electrical characteristic of micron-sized MOS devices. And then we have all 10 sections: threshold voltage, geometry effect, and backgate bias of threshold voltage and things like that, okay? And then we're going to discuss about the alternative MOS technologies. This is MOS devices which has been exercised in the VLSI. Especially the LDD structure is commonly used for the VLSI recently. But the SOS, the silicon, wait a minute. Silicon on the sapphire, that is the SOS stands for that. And this is not really common devices, but we can talk about this as alternative. When you reduce the MOS devices, we have more physical problems and we have strange electrical properties, so that we have to develop some new idea to overcome that. And these are the structures that we are going to discuss as an alternative as we get down the scales, okay? And then in the chapters 7, electrical characteristic of, wait a minute, where is it? Electrical characteristic of a micron-sized bipolar devices and alternative bipolar technologies. We are not going to talk about the miniaturization, scaling of bipolar devices, because in nature, the bipolar is not good for the miniaturizations. I mean, for the integration. Most of the integration is from the MOS transistor rather than the bipolar transistors. But we are going to talk about the electrical properties when we reduce the bipolar devices, even though we are not going to talk about the physics for the miniaturization of the bipolar devices. We have to deal with the electrical properties, like scaling, heavy doping effect, contact effects, and the VLSI structures of a bipolar. And briefly, if we have a time, we are going to talk about the alternative bipolar technologies as well. That is the contents, that is the sections we are going to discuss in this lecture, okay? Let's turn on the lights. We don't, let me see. How can you turn off the projector? Before we really get into the lecture, I want to talk about the material science and engineering a little bit, okay? The materials. The human history has been distinguished according to the tools, right? Tools. For example, Stone Age, and we have a Bronze Age, and we have a Iron Age, and now we can say the new Stone Age, because the silicon, the most important semiconductor these days, this is a kind of a stone, okay? So we can call these days a new Stone Age, okay? And all these things consist of the tools, and the most important thing is the tools. Okay. Now, these tools, of course, it is made with the materials, and as you can see, the stone, bronze, iron, and the new stone, the silicon, all those are materials. Okay. So that materials is very important. It is everything, we can say. Okay. But you may say, our department is called MS&E, which means Materials Science and Engineering. Most of the academic field can be distinguished as science or engineering. Okay. For example, the physicists, they are dealing with a perfect solid, perfect solid. Okay, chemistry. They are dealing with the gas or liquid, not the solid. So chemistry, chemist and the physicist, they are the typical scientists, okay, science. For the scientific people, the curiosity. That's everything. They are doing research just because they want to know why. Okay? But electrical engineering. We are not going to call the electrical engineers to be a scientist, right? We never call the electrical science. We just call it, that is the engineering, electrical, civil engineering, mechanical engineering. Okay, these guys are engineers, and then they have to answer why they're doing this, what for. This is very important for the engineers. The curiosity is not a thing they are going to be concerned with. So from 1920, the academic research has been developed since 1920, we can say. And those days, the science and engineering is so much different. They do not communicate each other. It's so different field, okay? But through 1940 and 1960, and now here in 1980, this science and engineering is very close. Why? Because every scientist, they have to answer, why are you doing this? What for? Just with the curiosity, they cannot get the research fund anymore, okay? And for the engineers, they want to make a revolutionary change instead of an evolutionary change. Okay, revolutionary change rather than evolution. For the revolutionary change, they need to understand the basic feature of everything. Okay? So engineers' approaches to the scientific features, and then scientists have to get close to the engineering features. So in 1980, the science and engineering really get close, and we cannot distinguish the science and engineering. Now, what about the material science? For the material science, we have to have engineering feature and science feature at the same time, because where is it? How can I get? Material science and engineering, we have a goal. Okay? We have to have a goal. We need something
material strong or soft or for certain characteristic, we want to have some materials with a certain characteristic. And if you want to make, for example, a soft, strong, then you have to understand the fundamental feature, why material get strong, stronger. And to find that the reason is belonging to the science. After we find the fundamental reason, then we have to engineer to make the materials more stronger. Yes. And that is the engineering feature. So, for example, the salt, which is a very important in all the days, the material scientists, they come to know the defects, especially the line defect, which is dislocation, okay? Dislocation is related to the strength of the material. And then after they find that, then they begin to develop the technology how to make those defects in the steel, in the material. Okay, that is engineering. So if the material science and engineering, they had a goal to make something strong, make something bright or whatever, then they have to do the science and do the engineering at the same time. So that's why we call it material science and engineering, this department of material science and engineering. There are not many academic fields which can be called science and engineering at the same time. I think computer science and engineering maybe is another academic field to be called science and engineering at the same time. And material science and engineering. Otherwise, we never call the electrical engineers to be the scientists. They don't want to know why. They just want to develop the technology how to make the resistance small. And they don't want to know why the materials can get the resistance reduced. They just put something, for example, for silicon, they just dope the dopant, boron, arsenic, antimony, and they make the silicon, the resistance of the silicon reduced, right? But the material scientists, they want to know fundamentally why only boron or phosphorus or arsenic, antimony are going to be used as a dopant. Why not zinc, something like that, okay? To find the materials more, less resistant, to make the materials more less resistant, something like that. So the material science and material science and engineering has to be the name of this department. The things we are going to discuss in this class, we have engineering features and scientific features at the same time. So it may be interesting for you to, for each sections, you have to see the scientific feature and an engineering feature, okay, in every section. Okay, we are going to, in the chapter 2 and 3 has been devoted for the introduction of advanced MOS technologies and bipolar technologies, but then, from chapter 4, we begin to talk about the point defects. And I want to mention why we are interested in the point defects among other kinds of defects. The volume defect and a hole, something like this. These are the three-dimensional defects, right? Two-dimensional defect, surface, grain boundaries, things like this, okay? And the line defect, typical line defect is at this location. Edge dislocation, screw dislocation, whatever. And the point defects. Point defect, the interstitial, substitutional, and interstitial. These are the point defects. If you are mechanical engineers or electrical engineers, you might not be familiar with these terms. But for the material scientist, every term is very familiar. You have to be familiar with these terms. Okay. Now, among these all different kinds of defects, why are we interested in point defects? The reason is simple. These defects are important for their own features. The reason why we are interested in point defects is not point defects are most important. The reason why we are interested in point defect is that only the point defects is thermally equilibrium properties. Yes. In other words, if the concentration of the point defects, it can be defined as a Arrhenius type plot like this. Other defects, line defects and two-dimensional defects and volume defects, it is not the following the thermal equilibrium properties. It cannot be represented with this equation, Arrhenius type equations. Arrhenius type equations. The beauty of this Arrhenius type equation is that when you get the log of this, then you are going to have equations like this, and when you plot that, then you're going to have a straight line. So we can get the extreme values. Not only we can get the extreme values here with the intersection with the y-axis, but also from the slope we can have the activation energy. We can get the idea of the activation energy. What is the meaning of this activation energy? This activation energy is related to the basic mechanism. What's happening? Why it happens? This activation energy is going to be the clue to see what really happens in the sections, in the process. For example, the oxidation process, silicon oxidation, is the silicon surface, and when it placed on in air, okay, and then you heat it up above 1,000 degrees centigrade, then the surface of silicon, the dangling bonds, is going to react with this oxygen to get a silicon oxide, okay? This is a very beautiful material. There are many kinds of oxide, right? But among those, the silicon oxide is a really gift from the God. Let me tell you, the aluminum oxide, for example, this is the oxide, another oxide. And then another oxide is iron oxide. Okay, this aluminum oxide is so dense, and if you have a 50 angstrom as aluminum oxide, no more oxidation happens. You cannot develop more oxidations after 50 angstrom on the surface of aluminum. That's why you can use this aluminum as a beverage can, right? And what about the iron oxide? You can have as thick as you want. You can place it in the salt, for example. You can have iron oxide forever, but it's not dense at all. You can just rub it off. So this is not a dense. You can have a thick oxide, but it is not dense. This is too dense, so that you can have only 50 angstrom. But for the semiconductors, you need the oxide thickness at least more than 100 angstrom. And you don't need oxide more than 2 or 3 microns. And you have to have some kind of density. It should be very hard. It should not be taken off, rubbed off. And the silicon oxide is just for this. So this is amazing material. Now, everybody want to know why the iron oxide, you can have oxidation forever, and the aluminum oxide, why we cannot have only just a 50 angstrom oxide? And everybody want to know why the silicon case, we can have just the proper density and the proper thickness of the oxidation. And the clue, we can get a clue from this Arrhenius type plot. Okay, when you plot the thickness of the silicon oxide and the temperature, the oxidation temperature, reciprocal of oxidation temperature, then you are going to have a straight line, and then that activation energy that is corresponding to the 2.0 electron volts. And this 2.0 electron volts is very close to the silicon-silicon bonding energies. Okay, so in this case, the oxidation happens by breaking the silicon-silicon bond. That is a covalent bond, right? That is the example of this thermal equilibrium properties, and only 0.5 is related with the thermal equilibrium properties and other defects, we cannot make a prediction. For example, if you want to make a salt strong, okay, what you have to do is you have to create the dislocations inside the iron, the salt material. But you cannot make a mathematics how dense the dislocation should be, the population, I should say, the ions. And when you heat, the salt, the ions, and then you hit it with a hammer to make it strong, and the action of heating the ion is actually creating the creation of the dislocations. And you cannot make a prediction how many times you have to hit the salt. And you cannot make a really relations between the heating and the dislocation densities. So this is the equilibrium values. You cannot make a prediction of this. And surface, the rim bounded also, you cannot make a Arrhenius type plot or predictions or equilibrium values never exist on those things. So the pointed effect, the main concern of our lecture, and that the pointed effect is really related to the diffusion phenomenon and an oxidation phenomenon, then we have this and other scattering thing, iron implantation, then crystal damage and the healing. All those things are related to the pointed effect. So that's why at the first part of this lecture, we mainly concerned with the pointed effect. And at the later part, we have to discuss about the electrical properties related with the scaling of the devices. Okay, the book is ready by this afternoon, so if you have a time, you can pick up the book at 4 or 5 o'clock, maybe. That, is that late enough to pick up the book? Okay, on the third floor of my office. And I want you guys to read the chapter 2 and 3 at home. Okay, we are not going to talk about the chapter 2 and 3 in the class. And on Wednesday, we begin to discuss chapter 4. Any questions? My lecture is perfect, huh? No question at all. How about you? Are you from material science or what?
Material science.
Material science? So you're familiar with this defects and... okay. Who is not from material science? Is there anybody? Oh, where are you from? Electrical engineering, so you don't know interstitial, substitutional, well. There's three, only three of you from electrical engineers, and every other students are from material science. Who, except you, who is a foreigner? You're the only one. So I have to speak in English just for you, huh? These Korean students, they're supposed to lessen the English lecture. This lecture is supposed to be. Okay, I'll see you on Wednesday then. Please read, pick up the book and read chapter 2 and 3 at home.